In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Welcome, my brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, to this broadcast on Radio Maria, entitled Learning to Live in God's Divine Will. Learning to live is a process that lasts throughout our entire existence, not only on earth, but even in the next life. Indeed, the saints in heaven continue to grow in degrees in the divine will, and Jesus makes this very clear to Louisa. I addressed in a previous broadcast the unending degrees of living in God's divine will, which I will just touch upon very briefly since I already addressed this before, in order to then address the theme of Louisa combating the opposing forces to God's will on earth and in the next life also. But without any further ado, let me refer you to the expressions of our Lord found in Louisa's text that addresses the propensity of the human will to continuously increase in its pursuit of holiness in God's will, not only in this life, but in the next. Taken from volume 30, February 6, 1932, Louisa relates, I continue to follow the acts of the divine will, and my beloved Jesus added, my daughter, each time you form an act of yours, in the act of my divine will, you form many bonds. And as you form many bonds in the divine will, you remain more confirmed in it. This is very important here. So as we do our acts on earth, which include the most menial to the greatest, from brushing our teeth, to taking steps, to breathing, to blinking our eyes, to working, to praying, etc. Not only do we form many bonds in God's divine will, and what do bonds do if not strengthen us in that will whereby it's more difficult for us to leave it, but we remain more confirmed in it. Hence the importance of repetition, not mechanical, repetitive, pure repetitive executing of acts, but with desire and upright intention and firm resolve, placing everything we think, say, or do in God's divine will, we become more confirmed in it. And then Jesus continues in this passage, for as many acts you do in the divine fiat, so many more times does the divine will remain confirmed in you. And for each bond and confirmation that you obtain, my will expands these around you. And as a confirmation and as a seal, it issues forth one of its truths, a manifestation of additional knowledge, and it manifests to you one more degree of value that my will contains. So you see, the repetition of our acts throughout the day in God's divine will are always accompanied by a firm desire and upright intention, increases our degrees of living in God's divine will. That's incredible. How many acts, for example, do you do throughout one day? Thousands. That means you are increasing in thousands of degrees, provided you begin the day with your prevenient act, which seals all your acts throughout the day in God's divine will. And two, you renew this prevenient act throughout the day, which are your actual acts in the intellect, in the memory, in the will, and in the body. Jesus continues in the same passage. But do you know what these additional bonds, confirmations, truths, manifestations of knowledge and values that you come to know do in your soul? They make the life of my will grow in you. Not only do they do this, but when you repeat your acts in the divine will, they grow in many more degrees of value, for as many truths as you have come to acquire. So you see, these acts done in God's divine will on earth, as in heaven by the blessed and the angels, or living in God's divine will as well, never cease to increase within us the bonds, the confirmations, the truths, the values that God imparts to us by means of them. Jesus also reveals to Louisa in volume 30, February 10th, 1932, each time you elevate yourself in my will, to unite yourself, to act in it, the divine act rises and gives you a degree of grace, a degree of love, a degree of sanctity, a degree of divine life and of glory. These degrees united together form the necessary substance to form the divine life in the creature. One forms the heartbeat, another the breath. One forms the word, another the eye. One the beauty, the other sanctity of God in the depth of the soul. And here is what it means to live in my will, to unclutter oneself of everything and to fly into the womb of the Celestial Father, so that nothing may receive, so that this nothing, meaning Louisa, may receive the light of He who created it, meaning her soul. So Jesus repeats this often throughout the writings, whether it be volume 32, March 14th, 1933, volume 28, March 2nd, 1930, volume 29, October 30th, 1921, volume 22, September 14th, 1927. I could rattle off to you about 16 passages, 16 to 20, where Jesus speaks of unending degrees in his divine will, not only on earth, but in heaven, by virtue of the acts that are performed in his will. So the program entitled Learning to Live in God's Divine Will is a process that never ends. And that is why I chose this title for this program. I want to convey to all the listeners that living in the divine will is nothing you can put in your pocket and say, I did it, now I can continue doing whatever I was doing before. It's not something that can be achieved once and for all. It is something that is always being achieved. Certainly, it takes time for us to enter it. Well, let me rephrase that. Certainly, it takes time for one to remain in it continuously, to enter and remain within it continuously. And what is that time? Growth in virtue. Through frequent reception of the sacraments of confession and communion, through a steadfast daily prayer life, through acts, corporal and spiritual, of mercy, through rounds throughout creation in the divine will, through the prevenient act offered every morning, through meditation of the Passion of our Lord at least a little bit every day, through the acts that we do all the time in the body and in the soul that we offer up in God's divine will. All these render us stable in God's divine will, but it takes time because the virtues that dominate our body and our soul mature over time through exercise, repeated good acts. Certainly, it takes time, but once we enter into the divine will, which can happen immediately for anyone in the state of grace with a firm desire and upright intention. And then we, through time, learn to remain in it. We attain what's called the state of living in the divine will. This is a permanent state that begins on earth and continues throughout eternity in heaven. It's different from degrees that I'm addressing. So there's the state, which is the, Jesus refers to it as the ambience of eternity, this mode of eternity, or eternal mode, in which the soul is grounded, rooted, firm in the divine will. And as that soul is living firmly in this eternal mode of God's divine will, it continues to grow in unending degrees. So what I'm trying to convey to you is that there is a stability, a permanency of the divine will in the soul. It takes time to attain that. You can enter immediately, but you could also exit immediately, which happened with Louisa for several years in her teen years, till she attained the state of perpetually living in it at the age of 24 on the eve of the feast of St. Mary, the birthday of St. Mary, the Virgin Mary. You know, people call her the Virgin Mary. Very few people call Mary a saint, you know. I wonder why, because she is a saint, you know, even though she was conceived without original sin, and hyperdulia is offered only to her among all the saints, dulia to the other saints, hyperdulia to Mary, and latria only to God. She still is, should be referred to also as Saint Mary. You know? And this permanency that Mary possessed on earth, and that we may possess on earth, and all the blessed and angels possess in heaven, does not mean that we cease to grow in degree. We continue to grow in degree, all right? Now, on to the theme of Louisa and her combat with evil. Now, Louisa was no stranger to the devil, and God availed himself of the devil in order for the divine will to reign on earth. He allowed Louisa to be harassed by the evil one. And this combat is accented in volume one more than any other volume. And it is not unfamiliar to the combat that many other saints struggled with that came before and after Louisa. Louisa went through a dark night of the soul, that an expression coined by Saint John of the Cross. She had to undergo purification before Jesus united her to spiritual marriage. And this period of purification and testing is akin to many of us in this godless society in which we live. That is not so much the fault of the masses as it is of those to whom the masses are entrusted, that enact godless laws upon the masses, like abortion, same-sex marriage, etc. So we can draw from Louisa's example in how to deal with these opposing forces of the divine will in order to make the divine will reign on earth by means of these opposing forces. Louisa's description in volume one helps shed light on why God is allowing for you to go through a purification, a testing. I'll share with you just a few passages here that touch upon what we are going through today. She relates in volume one. Now, volume one was not marked by many, if any, dates, you know. I think, if my memory doesn't fail, there's only one or two dates in volume one because she could not recall the dates. She wrote it after she had written other volumes at the request of Father Gennaro Di Gennaro. So in writing volume one, he relates that after some time I've experienced Jesus' presence on and off, that is, he would appear to me and then not appear for some time, I experienced him more intimately when I was united with him after Holy Communion. He asked me various questions, for example, if I loved him. I was ready to do what he wanted, even at the sacrifice of my life for love of him. He also said to me, "You may tell me what it is you desire. If you are ready to do what I desire, I too will tell you, will do what you desire." Isn't that beautiful? And this applies to us. When we are ready to do what God desires in our lives, He then is ready to do what we desire. Because our wills are now abandoned to His will. And Louisa replies, but I was perplexed as I could not understand his behavior toward me in this way. But with time, I understood that this way of Jesus behaving toward me is intended to dispose me to new and heavy crosses. He knows how to draw the soul so close to himself with these loving designs of his in such a way that the soul does not dare to oppose his desires. And I said to him, yes, I love you, Jesus, but why ask me if I am ready to do what you desire when it has been so long since I had already given you my will and implored you not to spare me in any sacrifice so that I may please you? And Jesus would on various occasions ask me, are you truly ready for whatever I desire? And I was more perplexed and humbled and almost trembling, said, yes, I am ready. And he lovingly would say to me on various occasions, do not fear, I will be your strength. For it is not you that will suffer, but I myself will suffer and fight within you. See, I want to purify your soul from even the slightest stain which might hinder my loving you. I want to test your fidelity, but how can I see if you possess true love if not? By placing you in the midst of battle. Know then that I want to place you in the midst of demons. I will give them the freedom to torment you and tempt you so that after you have fought the vices of the demons with the opposing virtues, you may find yourself in possession of the very virtues you think you are losing. Then your soul purged, embellished, and enriched will be like a king returning victorious from a raging battle, who, while he thought he would lose what he possessed, comes back more glorious and filled with immense riches. It is true that your state will be difficult, for the demons will give you no peace, neither by day nor by night. They will always be engaged in waging a raging war against you, but always keep your mind focused on my indwelling that I wish to establish in you and how I wish to make you similar to me. Know that you will be able to arrive at this indwelling only by means of much courage that you will draw from me and which will sustain this difficult period. Do not afflict yourself with such discouraging thoughts, but know with great trust that I will never allow the demons to tempt you beyond your strength. What I allow them to do to you, I allow for your own good. For I never place souls in battle with demons so that they may perish. Rather, I first measure the soul's strength. I then give it my grace, and only then do I decide to place it in battle. And if some soul should fall during the battle, it is because they do not remain united to me by means of prayer. I want to pause here. This is the key. This is the key of living in the divine will amidst opposing forces in the secular world in which we live in these end times. Steadfast daily prayer life is the key. Not praying Monday, Thursday, Saturday, or when I'm in a crisis. No, it's praying every day steadfastly and not altering your prayer. And when I say not altering your prayers, what I intend is not being a robot and saying everything repetitively every day, but not cutting back on your prayers. And Jesus, you'll find in a moment, tells the Louisa to do the same, to never neglect her daily prayers. And Jesus adds, it is because in neglecting prayer that a soul falls it becomes insensitive to my love and chooses to go begging for love not from me but from other creatures. In neglecting prayer, the soul does not let itself be guided by the sure path of obedience to those whom I have placed in its path and who can guide it in my stead. But such a soul relies on its own human judgment. So why should one wonder when such a soul, by relying on itself, should lose heart and fall during the battle? Therefore, what I recommend to you, Louisa, in this battle, is prayer. Even if you should suffer the pains of death, you must never neglect the prayers that you have been doing. And the more you see yourself surrounded by the abyss of the darkness of the demons, the more you should invoke the help of the one who can free you. What is more, I want you to place yourself blindly in the hands of your confessor without examining what is being said to you. Okay, now, of course, this injunction is specifically for Louisa because she was given a confessor whom God had endowed with special graces to guide her. But it can also apply to us within the context of our vocation in the world. And we should pray, as did Faustina when she did not have a confessor for months, to obtain one by invoking the Holy Spirit. If you read the diary of Faustina, she says that she needed guidance from a priest when the priest God sent her to was called away for a few weeks. Father Andrats was called away and she needed guidance. And he was back at the time of Faustina, there was no internet, there was no Wi-Fi. She couldn't just go in them, you know. So she waited for him to come and he wasn't returning. So she invoked the Holy Spirit and God sent her one. So she had Father Andrats, she had Father Sopochko. And remember the counsel I shared on this program about 6 weeks ago, reading to Hannibal's letter to Louisa, telling her that he is okay with Father Benedict Calvi, a second confessor, guiding her when he is away, but Father Benedict is to report to him everything that Louisa did and said, as best he could, and the counsel he gave her. Now, this is brilliant counsel on the part of Father Hannibal, and this tells you why the church made him a saint. He had tremendous spiritual insight, and this is how it should be with us. I know people in the Catholic world, and I'm sure you do as well, and you may be one of them, that seek out more than one priest for direction. You have to be careful here, because if you don't have a consistency with one priest, but you flutter like a bumblebee from one to another to another, you will be confused, and so will your confessors. You have to have stability, consistency with one confessor. When I say confessor, what I'm really referring to is a spiritual director, and that is what Jesus is referring to here. Technically speaking, you can go to any confessor. You don't have to have one. But in the spiritual world, you should refer principally upon one spiritual guide. Or you may call him a spiritual director, but always use a small s and a small d, because the Holy Spirit is your principal spiritual director, capital S, capital D. And this principal spiritual director in the form of a priest, if he is away for a while or is not available all the time, should allow another to guide you, but on the condition that that one informs him, because he needs to know, being your spiritual guide or director, of what counsel the other is giving you so that the two do not conflict, which they will if they don't communicate with each other, you see. St. Teresa of Avila observed this principle as well, who came before Hannibal. She had about four spiritual guides. They were all very bright. They were all theologians. And she was very bright herself. She learned from them. And she had one, though, that she would go to all the time. Even when he was away, she would consult with three others, but she would always report back to that one what the other shared with her. And if she wasn't enabled to, they would inform that priest of it, you see. So Jesus tells Louisa that she is to obey blindly Of course, as I mentioned earlier, this confessor is not just any confessor. He's a spiritual guide who was endowed with special grace specifically for Louisa's mission, to obey him blindly without examining what he says. Okay. Now, the devil attacks you and I when we seek to live in the divine will. He didn't just attack Louisa. His attacks are not limited to her. He hates the divine will. I want to share with you something personal that happened to me 1 hour ago. This is why I'm sharing it with you, because it's fresh on my mind. I just finished preparing an article for a bishop and for a priest who's entrusted with many seminarians. And this priest is denying the imprimatur, I mean the hill upstart, of an inspired work approved by the Catholic Church. So I address this priest in writing, because he's from another country, informing him that he has no authority to do this, because the Church's code of canon law that no priest can change empowers with authority the local ordinary, the bishop, to give his seals of approval upon a work he deems to be free from errors in morals and faith. And unless these seals are rescinded, which they have not been, nor in my opinion will they ever be, this priest has no authority to stop this work from being shared with those under him. Okay? Now, this is an attack to the unawares, I'm sure, of this priest. I'm sure he thinks he's doing what is right. But he hasn't read a word of what he's not allowing that has received the Church's official seals of approval. So I have to inform him, which is my duty as a theologian. That's not just an option, it's my duty. If you are aware of a document from the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith, the Vatican, entitled Donum Veritatis, on the gift of truth, which is the vocation of the theologian has an obligation to all to speak the truth in love. And if someone says something that's against church teaching, he has an obligation to correct that in a fraternal and charitable way. So we oftentimes will find this. And, oh, what was I going to share with you? That just happened an hour ago. About 20 minutes after I sent out this letter intended for the bishop and this priest, not this country, another country, I used the GPS, this navigational system for the vehicle on my phone to guide me to a local cafe, because you know me, I'm Italian, I like my coffee. And I always have more than one cup a day. And as I turned it on, I kid you not, it was possessed by the voice of Satan. The GPS navigational system, and I cannot imitate Satan's deep guttural voice, began to talk to me through it. All right. And this happened for about 20 minutes. And he wasn't just giving me indications of where to go. He started talking about glory and the glory of these spirits. You may think I'm inventing this. I am not. I'm telling you the truth. It's happened about an hour ago. And this is not the first time this has happened to me. This is the first time he spoke to me directly through the technology. In the past, he's broken down things in one day. After I come back, for example, from a retreat when I went to Vietnam, China, Australia, Philippines, Greece, Italy. Over 2 months, I went preaching throughout these countries. The day I came back, my cell phone died. I don't mean the battery died. The cell phone died. It crashed. Within an hour and a half, the furnace broke. It was wintertime. Within 20 minutes, 25 minutes after the furnace breaking, the power shut down in the whole block where I lived. All right. And then when the power came on, the computer crashed. All this happened in a day. This is not a coincidence. Anyway, I share this with you because when you seek to live in God's divine will, you will be harassed by the demons. There is nothing to fear in all this, because as long as you maintain a steadfast daily prayer life and observe the things Christ had asked Louisa to observe when she is being attacked, God's strength and his courage within us will thwart these attacks. And not only thwart them, but God will avail himself of these attacks to make his will reign on earth. And Jesus revealed this to Louisa as well on many in many passages. Padre Pio affirms as much when he says that God will make use of all of Satan's attack to bring about a greater good for those who love him. Because in the test, we are purged, illuminated, and unified, just as Louisa was. Now, I want to talk on the same theme about the seals of approval granted to Louisa Picaretta, because not many people talk about these, and they're, in my opinion, very important. They are official magisterial seals of the church. Remember, Hannibal ordered Louisa to write The Hours of the Passion, that he in turn reviewed and printed in 4 editions, bearing the nihil obstat that he impended to them, and the imprimatur of the archbishops of Trani, not just one, but several. And these editions of 1915, 1916, 1970, 1925 had these imprimaturs in the nihil obstat. That's 4. He also reviewed, edited, and printed Louisa's first 19 volumes that bore the same seals. Okay. And the Virgin Mary in the Kingdom of the Divine Will also bears these seals as well. Father Benedict Calvi published a summary of the first 4 volumes with some changes from the original text under the title, In the Kingdom of the Divine Will. First part, The Story of the Soul, The Rising Sun. Many people don't even know this work existed, and it still exists in Italian. And in Italian, the original title was Nel Regno della Divina Volontà, Prima Parte, I'm sorry, Parte Prima, Storia di un'anima, Alba che Sorge. That was a work by Father Benedict Calvi, a summary of the first 4 volumes with some changes from the original text under that title. With the imprimatur of Archbishop Joseph Leo. How many people know that this book exists? But it exists, right? And Father Calvi published the 3rd edition of the book, The Blessed Virgin Mary in the Kingdom of the Divine Will, also bearing the imprimatur of 1932, with subsequent editions of 1933, 1937, bearing the ecclesial permission. Father Ludwig Bethe, a German priest, a Benedictine priest, in 2 thick editions, put out a 5th edition of The Hours of the Passion. He was also preparing a 6th edition in 1934, translated into German. And these have the imprimatur. So you see, Louisa's volumes have many, and her writings have many seals, official seals of the church. So when people, even today, and this happens today, on radio programs, Catholic radio programs, discourage you from following Louisa's spirituality or her writings, do not listen to them. They have no canonical authority to dissuade you or to stop you from reading a work that bears these official seals of approval. And if anyone should tell you to do that, you can tell them. They have no authority by canon law that they cannot change to do so. Remember that always. They are misinformed. All right, I wish to pause here and just remind you of the importance of continuing to support this radio broadcast. Radio Maria, or as we say in Italian, Radio Maria. You know, it's all over Italy, too. It's based in Rome, and it's spread throughout all of Italy and many other countries. They rely upon you for donations to continue, because it's listener supported, 100% commercial free. So don't be a piker, be a generous giver in the Lord's vineyard, and God will reward you accordingly. Now, the evil one. Recently, a film came out that was supposed to portray the life of Father Gabriel Amor, my mentor in exorcisms and demonology. I've not seen this film yet. Well, number one, I don't have a television. I don't have television programs. I have a screen, but I can use the internet for that. So I've not yet seen the film, but I read up on it. And from what I understand, it does not represent the true life of Father Amorth, nor true facts about demonology. It's basically a fictitious representation done by Hollywood that uses maybe 20 to 30% of what is true, and the rest is all made up by Hollywood. Okay. And one of the things I read in this film that is not true is that I think the percentage was only 4% of cases involve spiritual affliction and the rest is all psychological. And that's completely false. Because I know Father Amat, I worked with him and I have his books, many of which are not yet translated into English. One of which is entitled Psychology and Psychiatry. No, it's called Esorcisti e Psichiatri. Yeah. Psychiatrist and Exorcist. And other books that are not yet in English, in which he talks about the statistics. And I will share some of this with you since we're on the theme of how to combat evil and how Jesus instructed Louisa to do so. There are three causes always of diabolical affliction that come by way of the soul, the mind, or the body. If this diabolical affliction comes by way of the body, a medical physician should be involved along with an exorcist. If the source is in the body, a physician should be involved with an exorcist. Remember, the key word is source. There are outcroppings. Whenever there's an affliction of one, there's an outcropping upon the other. So if the source is in the body, there will be manifestations also in the mind and in the soul. I'll make a distinction in a moment between the mind and the intellect, which is the faculty of the soul. When I say mind, I mean the brain, the organ, the physical entity. Okay. If the source, on the other hand, is not the body, but the mind, the brain, a psychologist should be involved along with the exorcist. But if the source is not in the body, nor in the mind, but in the soul, namely the intellect, the memory, or the will, then a priest should be involved, namely an exorcist. The majority of diabolical afflictions do not occur in the body nor in the mind, but they occur in the soul, with outcroppings on the other two, the mind and the body. What is important is that we attack the source. And first we identify the source, and then we attack the source accordingly. Now, there are different types of diabolical affliction on the soul. You have possession, which is the most rare. Then you have oppression, obsession, fixation, and possession. And these are general afflictions that can assume other forms, but I mentioned the principal ones, the general ones, because most people are familiar with these. And the way in which you combat them is the way in which Louisa did, without neglecting daily prayer. We enter more deeply into the presence, the indwelling of Christ within us, whom we received, remember, at baptism. He never left us. Certainly, when we commit a grave sin, are cut off from grace, but not all grace. Otherwise, we would cease to exist. Natural grace keeps us alive. actual grace continues to inspire us to repent. If all grace were cut off from us when we commit a grave sin, we would not even be disposed to confess. Who enables us to repent after we sin like Adam and Eve did and to return to the grace of God, if not God himself? So that grace is always at work in us. But it's the saving grace that we cut ourselves off from when we commit a grave sin. We are destined to go to hell if it's a grave sin. So God comes to our aid in our weakness, as St. Paul says, to dispose us for repentance in order that God may come back to life within us and lead us back to heaven. So Jesus tells Louisa that we must never neglect our prayers, but enter within this indwelling of God in us that we received at baptism, that we received an increase of at confirmation, and a continuous increase of with the reception of the sacraments of confession and communion. Jesus tells Louisa, remember, you will be surrounded by intellectual darkness and will be like one who has eyes with which to see your reason. And will be like one who has no eyes with which to see or reason, and who needs a hand to guide her. The eye for you will be the voice of the confessor, which like light will disperse the darkness from you. The hand to guide you in the darkness will be obedience to your confessor, who will be your guide and support to make you reach the safe harbor. The last thing I recommend to you, Louisa, is courage. I want you to enter the battle with ironclad determination. The thing that an adversary's army fears the most, is to see a soul that faces the most dangerous battles with courage and fortitude and fears nothing. Know that the demons fear nothing more than a courageous soul, who clinging to me with its being and with a strong spirit, faces them not to be wounded, but with a firm resolution of disarming them and exterminating them. The demons are frightened, terrified, and would rather flee than face a courageous soul. So there's your answer. Fear not, Jesus says, it is I. And St. Teresa of Avila said, without God, we can do nothing, but with God, we can do anything. So that is the key in order for us to oppose the opposing forces to God's divine will in these end times that are all around us. To fear not, have no anxiety, but with a firm resolution, an upright intention, a steadfast daily prayer life, the frequent receptions of confession and communion, the prevenient act every morning, the rounds throughout the day, the actual act throughout the day, and the meditation on the Passion of our Lord, we will be stably anchored in the state of living in the eternal mode of God in his one divine act, while increasing in unending degrees, not only on earth in that one state, but throughout all eternity. And in closing, I encourage you to remember always in your daily prayers your shepherds, beginning with the Roman Pontiff, including the patriarchs. Remember, the Eastern churches are part of the body of Christ, and we must pray for these leaders too. The patriarchs, the priests of both the Eastern, the Catholic as well as the Orthodox faiths, as well as all Christian pastors who are neither Eastern or Western in their faith, but nonetheless are baptized and baptized. We are all part of the one mystical body of Christ. And this is why Our Lady asks us, at Medjugorje, for example, pray for your shepherds. They need your prayers now more than ever. Why? Because before you, the laity, we, the shepherds, are targeted by Satan. He knows that if he takes out the leaders, the laity are helpless. you have no spiritual support of the sacraments, no spiritual support of teaching of the magisterium. We, the shepherds, hold the keys of knowledge of which Jesus spoke, and we are to invite you in, not keep you out. And if you hear shepherds telling you not to read these writings of Louisa that have been approved by the church and that bear the canonical authority for you to read, that no priest can deny you of, you must forge ahead with courage, with stout-heartedness, without fear, because you have the backing of Christ and his church, the magisterium. So may God bless you and keep you always in his most holy will. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. When I speak of it sometimes being mixed with witchcraft, this is the truth. Look at the Gnostic heresy of the early centuries. It took truths from Scripture, but it mixed it with their own esoteric theology, which was influenced by witchcraft. This is found recently, messages I've come across talking about oil curing all COVID, oil curing the flu and different communicable diseases. This is where thieves' oil gets its name from. Four thieves robbed the bodies of victims during the bubonic plague and managed to escape without being infected because they had these oils. And for centuries, witchcraft has used these oils for protection. I see this resurfacing in many seers saying this will help you, this will protect you. You have to be careful here not to be deceived. What does all this do? Promotion of fear, fright. It disposes the readers, the blog followers, the website readers, to depend upon them and not the church.
Damn it, Thomas, look at these names. Why can't you do as I did and come with us for fellowship?
And when we die, and you are sent to heaven for doing your conscience, and I am sent to hell for not doing mine, will you come with me for fellowship?